So I've heard a few things about structs, and I'm told that you can help us out with them. Can you help explain to me what a struct is?
Yeah, sure. So you're familiar with regular primitive data types such as int and char.
Yeah.
What structures do is they group these data types to create your own custom data type.
Okay.
And so conceptually, structs look a little bit like this. Beforehand, you would have variables to describe a person. So you might have an integer for their age. You may have a double for their height. And you might have a char star, effectively a string, to describe their name.
So in code, if I write this out, it'll just be int age, double height, char star name,
Yeah, that's
right?
correct.
So how does this relate to structs?
Well, what we can do is we can use a struct to group all these variables inside the struct. So a
Oh.
struct becomes like this.
So if you've got, sorry, yep.
And we can call the struct person.
Ah. So if we've got code where we're using person a lot, we're grouping three variables together. This would be handy because instead of having to type all three out at once, I'm guessing we've created just a struct person data type.
Yeah, that's correct.
Oh, that could be handy. So how would you write that up in code?
Yeah, no
Not
worries. I'll show
thinking.
you now. So we can start off by creating an int main function.
Yep.
And what we'll do here now is define what the structure looks like. So it's
Okay.
basically all the information we have here. We're laying out to the C compiler what the structure would look like in memory if we actually did declare a structure.
Okay.
So we first write the struct keyword, and then we give our struct a name. So in this case, we can call it person.
But we could do struct animal, struct sports.
Yeah, this name can be anything you like. And we then open the block of code, and we'll close it down here. What I'm going to do is put a semicolon after that. The reason being because you can put other things after this, but we're not going to for the moment. We will do
We
that
can look at
later.
that later.
Yeah, sure. And so now we need to list the fields that are inside the structure. So I'll just write down int age. And then we have a double height.
We're writing the code that we want to group together.
Yeah, exactly. And then we have a char star name.
Sorry, not code, variables. All right, cool. So now we've got these here. Let me just try this out for a bit. So if I was using int age on its own, I'll type that up as int age,
Yep.
right, semicolon. Now we both know that that's got garbage data right now.
That's
So
uninitialized, yes.
then we'll say age equals 18. Hey, happy birthday, 18.
Yep.
Okay, so struct person is a data type. Int is a data type. Something's missing. I'm guessing the equivalent of age. So how would you play with struct person?
Right, so we need to do two things here. We need to declare a variable, and then we need to initialize the values of that variable. And so what we're going to do is similar to your line of code that you have here, we're going to declare a struct person. So I'll just write out struct person, and then we can give our struct person variable a name, and we can call it perhaps example. So this is a very similar line of code to what you have. You have the data type here. I have a data type here, struct person. And then you have the name of your variable here, and I have the name example in the same format. And then what we can do is we can initialize our values of our struct person. So we have three fields here, age, height, and name, which I'm just realizing I'm missing a T there. And we can access these fields with the dot. So the dot is C's member access operator. And it can assign values and read values from the struct. So what we'll do is we'll write example dot and then the name of the field, age. And we can set it to 18.
Cool.
We can initialize the other two fields as well. So now we have a struct person in memory. It's both. It has an allocation of memory, and it's been initialized to the values we've set here.
Okay, so it's all very similar to using variables on their own, such as age, height, ints, doubles, and whatnot. Yep. But what if I wanted to say, extend this analogy by saying it's an integer pointer? Do we have struct pointers as well?
Yeah, absolutely. We do have struct pointers. You can create a pointer which points to a struct. One reason you might want to do this if you want to pass a structure into a function by reference. And the way we would do this is first we need to create the struct pointer variable. So we would write struct person star sp. So that is a variable called sp, which points to a struct person.
And now we need to give sp an address.
That's right. So we can give it the address of the example variable that we've made here.
Cool.
So sp is equal to the address of example.
That's a pretty good ampersand, by the way.
Thanks.
All right, so now we've got SP, it's pointing to a struct, and we can point it to other structs as well. Okay, so if we wanted to dereference age, we'll do star age equals whatever we want to set it to.
Sure.
Is it similar or the same to how we dereference structs?
It's a little bit different. It becomes a little bit of a difficult area. We need to dereference the SP, the struct pointer, first, and then we need to access the member of that struct. So what we will do is we'll write star SP. So that dereferences the struct.
Okay.
But we need to make sure this operation comes first, so we're going to put parentheses around it. And only then can we put the dot followed by the member within the struct, so example age. We can set that equal to 19.
Happy birthday, David. So you've dereferenced brackets, accessed the dereference struct, and he's had his birthday. Why the brackets? Why not just star sp.h?
Sure, so it comes down to a little bit of a technical problem within C. If you look at C's order of precedence for operations, the dot actually occurs before the ampersand. So what will happen is, without these parentheses, you'll be trying to access a member of a struct pointer, which hasn't been dereferenced yet.
And that's an address, and addresses don't have sub-variables.
That's the problem, yes.
Okay.
Addresses don't have members that you can access. You need to dereference first to find the structure, and then access a member.
Go to that address's location. Okay, yeah, I think I get it. So with the parentheses, the star, the dot, that's all a lot of typing for one action. Is there a shorthand way of doing it?
Yeah, absolutely. So C does provide a shorthand method for this, and it's a hyphen followed by a greater than sign.
Cool.
So the way we would write this is SP hyphen greater than sign to make an arrow, age is equal to 19. So this operator will both dereference first and then access the member within the structure.
Okay. So if I wrote the code that way, compiled it, then wrote the code that way and compiled it, would there be any difference in the binary?
No, there's no actual difference. The major difference is just in style. This one appears a lot simpler. Okay. It's less characters and easier to read.
Okay, very good. So I might want to write quite a few struct persons. Like we can save time by going from there to there, simpler. Is there a simpler way to declare a struct person?
Yeah, absolutely. So, first of all, if you want to declare a struct person within the definition, we can remove this semicolon here, and we can just write the name of the variable that we want to declare. Mm-hmm. So, in this case, it would be example. So, in this block of code, we have defined what a structure looks like, and then we said, hey, C compiler, can you set aside a piece of memory for this structure? And we want to call this structure example. So this now makes this line redundant. We don't need this anymore.
Okay, so that takes care of example in this case. What if I wanted to write example 2, example 3, or what if I wanted to write an array of struct persons?
So you can make a list of as many variable names as you want here, and so you can make a comma-separated list here if you want to.
Okay, so example, then comma, example underscore 2, for example. What if I wanted to declare another struct person, say, 10 lines down?
So you can do that just how we did before, using struct person and then the name of the structure.
Okay. But what about making it easier to declare each time?
Sure. So one thing that you can do to clean up your code a little bit is use a typedef. So what typedefs do is, say, every time that you see struct person in your code, yep, you can change it to something that's a little bit shorter or simpler.
Okay. And
so what we're going to do here is we're going to do this quickly here. We're going to write down the typedef keyword. And then what we're going to follow it by is the old type that we're typedefing. So we're going to write struct person. And then we're going to follow that by a name for our new type, which I'll put person underscore t. This is a little bit like a hash define. You have a keyword, and then you have your old type, and then you have your new type here.
Okay, so now every time that I want to declare a new struct person, instead of writing struct person example 2, I'll write person underscore t example 2.
That's right. Every time that struct person exists in the code, you can just write person underscore t.
Cool. Now, does it have to be like what we've named a struct followed by an underscore t?
No, it doesn't have to be. This is just something that I've chosen. It's probably a good convention to follow. The underscore t shows that it's a typedef type, so anyone who's reading this code will know it's been typedef.
So there I are... could draw it just like capital A, but that would be bad style.
Yeah, well, yeah, it would be a little bit. You could, like, some people will put a capital P in front of this or put the whole thing as uppercase. You can even have person. There's nothing wrong with having person in the compilation. It doesn't overlap with this namespace, but it is probably bad style.
Okay, cool. Okay, that's cool. Something else that just came to mind is, like, what if you had a pointer to another struct, so struct person was pointing to, had a pointer to another struct person. Can you do that?
Yeah, absolutely. So the things you can contain within struct person are basically endless. You can have pointers within a structure, you can have structures within a structure, you can have arrays within a structure, anything you want. And that's where you would have many arrows followed by each other. So you might have a structure pointer followed by an arrow to access another pointer within your structure. Mm. And then another arrow to dereference that again.
Sounds a bit like somewhat related to linked lists.
That's right. We have a lot of videos on linked lists. They're a good thing to watch. And it's a good way to practice your understanding of structures.
So we can use this to, like, the linked list videos that are also up online. We can use them to really get an understanding of structures.
Yes, absolutely. One other thing that you might want to do is look at complex numbers. So you can make a library for addition, subtraction, multiplication, and division of complex numbers, and you can use that structure to actually represent the number itself, because complex numbers have a real and imaginary part.
And that might be good practice before starting on linked lists.
Yeah, absolutely.
Okay, cool. So, like, tell me if I've missed anything. So we've got the struct person here, and we've turned that into code there.
Yep.
And just the same as we use with int star age and with declaring and initializing, we've got to do that with this data in here as well.
Yep, sure.
So we've done that here, and we've played around with typedef, so instead of struct person, person underscore t in this case, and yep, we've looked at pointers as well. I think I've missed something. Okay.
One thing I should tell you about is why structs are actually important. So, imagine you're in a business and you need to keep track of maybe 50 or 100 employees.
Yeah.
If you did that the old way without structures, you may have 150 variables for each employee's age, height, and name. And so this is very difficult to set up in code. It would take a lot of time. And it's even worse to maintain. If you, say your boss says that you need to keep track of everyone's team. Well, now you need to add another 50 variables to your program just to keep track of every single person's team.
But with structures, we've grouped them up together here, and yeah, we can just change this.
Sure.
Add that team.
So you could add another line of code here, which could be an integer to describe a team number, and it would just be implemented within your whole program instantly.
Okay, and of course we'd have to change code to initialize and that sort of thing.
Yes. Like,
for example, down here. Okay, so that's all very good. I think I've got it. I'll go ahead and do the complex numbers and maybe even linked lists later, but thank you very much.
No worries, thank you.